Please be seated.
As the jury instructions as a whole undermined it. That's
did modify. But the but I think the larger point is that the jury was not ever told, or the defendant's impulse or the defendant's instruction was undermined by the jury by the judge every time.
Well, it's not sufficient. Isn't the larger point though that it's more likely that the jury received the proper instruction and what its rights are because the lawyer was allowed to argue with RSA 519-23A? Isn't that more likely?
The
jurors pay attention.
Well, the judge gave the defendant precisely the letter of the law. But what the judge did, what's insufficient here, is that the legislature, by doing this, undid that portion of Wentworth. It's not sufficient. By saying the legislature has disagreed with the jurisprudence of this court.
Where do you find that disagreement?
About halfway down the first big paragraph, it says the jury system's functions at its best when it is fully informed of the jury's prerogatives. And fully informed, it stands to reason, it does not believe that the current state of the law is fully informed.
Judge McCall, right?
Pardon?
Judge McCall, right?
No, I don't think it's judgment. I don't think it's a judgment call. I think that's an explanation of what's the matter with the current law in the legislature.
But you would say that the judge should not tell the jury that they should follow the law. There should be no statement, even as Judge Conway pointed out, they shouldn't even be told you should follow the law. It's what? I mean, why give any instructions at all? If it's really up to the jury to just, you know, decide what the facts are and the law is, why give
it up to the jury to decide what the facts are? And the jury should get instructed on what the law is, but the jury should not be told, do not follow, you know, don't listen to the lawyers explain if they say something different. You may convict if you find sufficient evidence, but not should. Should is a strong word. That's the Wentworth charge, and I think this statute changes the Wentworth charge to something more permissive, like a may rather than a should.
Did the charge include a pure so-called jury nullification instruction? In other words, if you find this fellow did this, but you don't think he should be convicted, that's okay?
The judge refused to give it. It was requested by both the state and the defendant to give a nullification charge.
But the interesting thing is that the precise statute that you're relying on does not say, and the judge must instruct on nullification. I'm looking at it right now, and although it's preceded by the general court's intent, the actual instruction to trial courts is that the defense must be permitted to inform the jury of its right. It doesn't say, and the trial judge must inform the jury. If we accept your position, we're reading words into the statute that the legislature didn't put there.
And in fact, Mr. Gordon, just to follow up on that, the legislature had that language in front of them,
correct,
which the court has to give that instruction and rejected it. Isn't that significant for our consideration?
I think the words fully informed do several things. One is a rule of construction, like the right to know statute, that what's in the preamble is a rule of construction that says you need to construe the statute in a broad way. And so it has four probable implications. One, the court, once the defendant gives the request, the nullification request, the prisal, the court has to get out of the defendant's way. The court can't then undermine it, because then you don't have a fully informed jury. You have a confusedly informed jury. What the defendants just said, the court took back, and the juror's going to say, oh, which is right, and the judge said I'm supposed to listen to him, not the lawyer, so I guess the nullification doesn't exist. That's what we have here. I think it also affects the Wentworth should-must distinction. I think probably, although we don't have the issue here, it makes nullification a defense, so that you can put on your expert witness if you want, that undoes the Hopkinson case, where the medical marijuana expert was allowed.
So in other words, if we accept that theory, doesn't that mean that basically trials are now turned into legislative committee hearings? If the issue is should marijuana be legal or not, you bring in all your experts to say absolutely marijuana should be legal. There's no brings in hits, and the, you know, this sort of one-day possession of marijuana trial or something is now goes on for, you know, what, 2 weeks or at least several days while we hear from all these experts?
Well, obviously the judge has some discretion to bring things in. But no, the reason it doesn't turn courts into legislatures is because this is necessarily rare. It requires that the defendant admit the conduct and admit the intent.
But it's only rare because this is relatively new. If we said this was okay, would it really be rare in the future? I mean, I would suspect that there would be a lot of people who would say, you know, particularly if the evidence of the crime itself is pretty strong. Hey, this, I'm gonna bet that I can get the jury to say the legislature was wrong in their choice of whether it's drugs or whatever the issue might be.
It just seems unreasonable to me that someone charged with a serious crime, assault or something, is going to say, yes, I did it, please don't convict me. And that's just an untenable position on prohibition or the future of the Slave Act or marijuana in our time. Maybe that might happen, but not in your general run of crimes, I don't think.
I remember rather vividly a case when I was in the trial court involving an habitual offender statute where the defendant did just that. He said, yep, I did it, but at least don't convict me because. So it does show up now and again.
Right.
And it happened with some frequency in the South, did it not? I mean, in the 60s and 70s, this white defendant murdered an African American, but...
Absolutely. But, you know, we have jury nullification in New Hampshire. And the question here is, how far does the statute go? And does it just require that the judge allow the defendant to give the charge like he did here? Or does it also allow the judge to then countermand that very same charge that the defendant just gave?
What the trial court did here, it seems to me, was comply with 519.23a, as you said before, and didn't countermand it. It allowed the defense to inform the jury of its nullification right, which in fact.
Your Honor, the judge really did countermand it. Look at the list on page 11 of my brief where I bullet these things. The judge really did take away
Your argument is when the legislature provides an overarching intent of a law, and then after it explains its overarching intent, it states the law. You say that we are allowed to read into the words of the law additional words that are gleaned from the intent, because that seems to be your argument.
No, actually not. It's like Lamy in the right to know context, where here are the exceptions, but this court has construed, rightly in my mind, the right to know law in light of the purpose and section of the statute. And that's what this is. This is a rule of construction. And so when the defendant gets when the defendant puts forth the nullification charge, and the very next thing out of the judge's mouth moments later is, oh no, that's not true, or don't listen to him, that is undoes what the defense
says. So from your standpoint, the instructions to the jury should contain no recitation of the substantive law.
Oh, absolutely not. No.
Right, so where do we slice it? So you say the judge can tell the jury what the law is.
He has to under Pearson.
All right, so you don't quibble with all of the instructions the judge gave in this case.
Correct.
You quibble with the occasions when the judge said, well, he did say you should follow the law and not you must follow the law. But then there are other times when he said, you take the law from me and not from the attorneys. You say, that needs to be wiped out of the
or modified
of the normal instructions that are given.
Modified in some way so that it's not such a opposite.
In this trial, were those specific requests made at the time?
Some were and some weren't.
So we have to look at every occasion and see if there was a preserved objection?
It's not hard to figure out. The trial attorney mentioned several of them. The judge changed one, but left the rest of them stand. And Wentworth, for instance, the judge never addressed, but it was raised. And so that's why. And there are, but this court looks at jury instructions as a whole, and I think parsing them like this is probably too far. And in addition, the jury...
parsing them like this is too far. That's what you're asking us to do, aren't you not?
No, but you take all these jury instructions as a whole, I think they undid what the defendant says. And in addition, the trial attorney asked the trial judge, do I have to stand up and object to each time I don't like what you say during instructions? And the judge says, no, I consider it preserved. So, you know, what was the trial attorney supposed to do in that case? You know, so I think it's preserved, and in the event that one or two are not preserved, the bulk of them are.
Thank you.
May it please the court, I'm Nicholas Corbett, representing the state. I'll take questions anytime.
Doesn't Mr. Gordon have a point here?
No.
If the argument is what the argument was in this case, but the trial judge said, basically, never mind, take it from me, not a problem?
Not at all. I have to begin by apologizing to the court for my failure to thoroughly research the legislative history of this statute. If I had done so, I would have written a very different and probably much shorter brief. As it is, I ask the court to disregard everything in my brief that concedes, implies, or suggests that this is a jury nullification statute. It is not. Not only does this statute not require trial judges to give nullification instructions, it also does not require them to allow defense counsel to argue nullification. We know this for certain because the original version of the bill that enacted the statute contained both requirements, and both were deleted before the bill was passed. And history clearly reveals that the bill would not have passed if they had not been deleted.
So what you're saying is that 519.23a simply restates what juries do all the time.
That is correct.
Because it says that the defense shall inform the jury of its right to judge the facts. Judging facts is what juries have historically done. And the application of the law in relation to the facts and controversy. That is what juries historically do. So you say that calling this a nullification statute is simply a wrong characterization. It is simply, you say, a confirmation of what juries have historically done.
That's absolutely right. If the court wishes, I'm ready to distribute copies of all the documents that I'm about to quote from. They're all part of the record of the general court, if you wish. The bill was introduced in January 2011. HB 146 was entitled, quote, an act relative to the right of jury nullification, unquote. The first sentence of the preamble read as follows, quote, under the decisions of both the New Hampshire Supreme Court and the United States Supreme Court, the jury has an undeniable right to judge both the law and the facts in controversy, unquote. The bill would have enacted a new statute, RSA 519.23a, whose text read in full, quote, in all court proceedings, the court shall instruct the jury of its inherent right to judge the law as well as the facts and to nullify any and all actions they find to be unjust. The court is mandated to permit the defendant or counsel for the defendant to explain this right of jury nullification to the jury, unquote. Roughly 6 weeks later, the bill was reported out of the House Judiciary Committee. The following is quoted from the official House record of February 23, 2011. HB 146, relative to the right of jury nullification, inexpedient to legislate. Representative Gregory M. Sorg for Judiciary. This bill would require judges in all court proceedings to, quoting from the bill, instruct the jury of its inherent right to judge the law and the facts and to nullify any and all actions they find to be unjust. End of quote from the bill. The committee concluded that as drafted, this bill would incorrectly instruct the jury to put the law on trial rather than the application of the law in the case actually before it. The committee further concluded that the so-called Wentworth instruction, by which the judge instructs the jury, that if it finds that the prosecution has proved all the elements of the crime beyond a reasonable doubt, it should find the defendant guilty, adequately informs the jury of its unquestioned right of nullification without misleading. Vote 15-0. End of quote. Less than a month later, the House amended the bill. It removed every single reference to nullification, including those in the preamble and the title. This version still required the judge to instruct the jury, but only on its right to judge the facts and the application of the law in relationship to the facts in controversy. Both in the preamble and in the statute, the jury no longer had the right to judge the law as well as the facts. The bill went nowhere in 2011, but it was carried over into the 2012 session, the second half of the biennium. When it finally was enacted in June 2012, only two real changes had been made from the amended version in March 2011. The preamble was shortened by removing a reference to the Seventh Amendment to the U.S. Constitution, and the statute no longer required the judge to give any instruction. It only says the court shall permit the defense in all criminal proceedings to inform the jury of its right to judge the facts and the application of the law in relation to the facts and controversy. Should have been clear already that the statute couched in these terms could have no connection to jury nullification, which is not a prerogative of the jury. It's not about the jury applying the law to the facts, it's about the jury ignoring the law, or as the original bill put it, judging the law, which in practice means judging the law to be wrong. But this history makes it even clearer. The statute as enacted says nothing about jury nullification because it originally did. And every one of those references was removed.
Your point is that the common law of jury nullification remains intact.
Correct. And it would controvert every tenet of statutory construction for this court now to rewrite the statute.
Let me just ask you this question. I read some very persuasive points, but I guess what is the purpose of this statute then? In other words, you're saying it doesn't change the law at all. So why did the legislature enact it? I mean, you're basically a sort of a sob to...
I'm about to get to that.
Okay.
Because it looks like there's inconsistency between its statement of intent and actually what the operative law says.
There are two questions that should be addressed. First, what did the Judiciary Committee mean when it used the phrase, its unquestioned right of nullification? Court context makes it clear it was not giving that phrase the meaning this court would give it, since the same report categorically denied the jury has the right to judge the law, and that's what jury nullification is. The committee was obviously talking about the power of nullification, because it said the Wentworth instruction adequately informs the jury, and this court, which created the Wentworth instruction, has made it clear that that deals with the power of nullification. And of course, the second question is a bit more problematic. Statute isn't about nullification, whatever. The question can only be answered by viewing the statute in its political context. I don't think it's unreasonable to suggest that there are two reasons why legislators either vote for or sponsor any given bill. Either they think it will benefit the people of the state, or they think it will benefit them politically. Clearly, there were a number of legislators who wanted to take credit for passing the jury nullification bill. As of February and March of 2011, every one of them knew that an actual nullification bill would never get through both branches or get signed by the governor. And it would have been very difficult at that time to say with a straight face that this statute was a nullification bill, because the Judiciary Committee's report was right there, and so was the original version. But this bill wasn't passed until June 2012. The original bill and the Judiciary Committee report were 15 months old. In politics, memories can be very short, and appearance is often more important than reality. When the bill was passed, its supporters claimed that it was a jury nullification bill, and they continue to do so. They even convinced me for a few months. So the statute is not meaningless politically. Legally, it pretty much is. It just codifies a right that was implicit, if not expressly stated in the case law, right of the defense to tell the jury that it has a right to apply the law to the facts. The law being the law as explained by the judge.
So what you would like us to do is to sort of end the sobbing, so to speak, of the
thinks that those who think jury nullification was really passed and say that this law doesn't do what at least some people thought that maybe it was going to do.
All I can say is this is the clearest legislative history I have ever seen. Now, the right of a jury to apply the law to facts can be important. For instance, in a case where the jury can acquit of the charged crime and convict of a lesser crime, if the evidence supports it. But there is no right of jury nullification. And this statute does nothing to change that. It's not a nullification statute. It is literally an excuse for a nullification statute.
Well, there is a right of nullification. It belongs to the jury.
There is a power of nullification. There is no right of nullification.
I think you're quibbling over the Magna Carta at this point.
That is a distinction that this court has drawn repeatedly. I am not making it up.
So,
the power of nullification is the ability to nullify without consequence to the members of the jury.
Sure.
But there is no right of nullification. It is an illegal action.
So when
we
talk about nullification, it's really a recognition of what juries can do, what they can do, as opposed to what they have a right to do.
Exactly.
And it's not quibbling. It's that distinction you say is very important.
It was made by the court in the Hughes case over 100 years ago.
And really, it's the double jeopardy clause that basically comes into play. Once the jury says not guilty, whatever the reason, there's no appeal by the state.
I've quoted some cases in my brief that describe the anomaly of jury nullification and point out that it's a consequence of several things, namely, as Your Honor points out, the fact that you cannot retry someone who's been acquitted, and the various rights of the defendant to a jury trial. And the fact that the jury cannot be punished for essentially violating their oath by exercising their power of nullification is the closest thing to a right that it is.
Well, that's interesting that you mentioned the oath, because no one's talked about that. Jurors take an oath to apply the law to the facts as they find them to be and to follow the court's instructions.
That's right.
The nullification. That's what the oath says.
There's at least one case in my brief that the quote says that jury nullification is against the law, but it is tolerated by the law. There's nothing further.
Thank you. Case submitted. Counsel may come forward.